Get this fixed up.
Oh, yeah, this thing only has 6 feet.
Good evening and welcome to our city council meeting for Tuesday, April 25th. Would you please join us in pledging allegiance to our country? Ready to begin? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Madam Clerk.
Does Jasmine call the roll? Councilmember Price?
Here.
Councilmember Adam?
Here.
Councilmember McCoy?
Present.
Councilmember Fox is absent. Mayor Bill De La Pena.
Present. Thank you. We will begin the evening with special presentations. And for the first special presentation, I would like to invite Mr. Frank Acree to the podium to make a big announcement. Hey. Welcome.
Happy Tuesday. Council folks and Mayor Bill De La Pena, it's a pleasure for me to announce that Conejo Valley Days is a nonprofit again. Yay! Took a long time to get it turned around and get it where it's supposed to be, but we're finally there. And we've turned the corner. We've got a lot of young, aggressive, intelligent adults in town that are really taking charge and kind of, you know, bringing it into the millennial, which we really needed. May 11th through May 14th is our dates this year. We've got world-class entertainment. I mean, everybody from Ambrosia to Player to Chevy Metal. And if you know who Chevy Metal is, I can't actually say it on the microphone. It's pretty impressive. People ask me why I'm so involved in Conejo Valley Days. And a short, brief history. My family's been here for almost 100 years. We opened up the first business in 1939, the water hole called Acree's Tavern, which was Jack's Tavern, and before that. And I've actually been lucky enough to sit on that bar stool and listen to all the old timers and all the stories. And everybody that was anybody came in there to have a private conversation that I listened to because I was 8 or 9 years old, so I knew what was going on. And So I've know where we started. I know where we are. Kind of have a feeling of where we're going. Conejo Valley Day started June of 1956. I was born June 1956, and it just seemed right that I should dive in there and kind of help the kids get a hold of it and take it into the future. It's really healthy right now. If you haven't seen Conejo Valley Days, you should come out and see it. The carnival, you know, we have a brand new carnival again this year. We negotiated a Thursday night special for the kids. It was a condition that I set in there that it seemed like it was getting expensive. So this year we're going to have $20 wristband nights. So kids can come for $20 and ride till they fall down. The spirit of Conejo, the Conejo Valley, really started in Conejo Valley Days. You know, it started with the Chumash Indians, it started with the Mexican gauchos and the ranchers, and everybody came together in springtime to celebrate, you know, the bounty. And if there was no bounty, then they pulled together and helped each other, you know, continue on. And I remember those days. You know, I remember the sheep on the boulevard, and I remember all that. And if I can pass along to the kids, the people who are taking over, what the spirit of the Conejo Valley is, I think I'll have done my job and I'll have run my course. So don't expect to see me too long. These kids are smart, really, really smart. I would love you to help me field a parade soon. If we do one every 5 years, would be fantastic. I promise you I'll make it easy on you. I'll do all the hard work. Maybe I can talk you into paying for the security and the sheriff's department and the barricades. But I'd love for us all to be together. Because at the end of the day, you know, There's money, there's fame, there's all the things that a lot of us have had and haven't had. But the one thing that we have that's the most important thing is we have each other. And God gave us that. He gave us each other. And I can't imagine not being with all of you and in this town of Thousand Oaks and Newbury Park. You know, I never want to leave. I left for a while. I came back. I just never want to leave. I want to die here. They're going to take me out of here in a box. So, having said that, please come to Kaneo Valley. Please come to Kaneo Valley Days and see what it is now. And see the smiles on these kids' faces. See the churches working together. And the synagogues and the mosques. And everybody's there. They're all working together. It's a new day. Thank you. Where are you going?
I'm going after you.
Oh.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
I personally am excited about the $20 wristbands for my children.
Oh, yeah, you're gonna
we'll
ride.
Definitely be there on Thursday. Thank you so very much. Well, we will probably be there more than once.
Oh, great.
Thank Congratulations, you. Too. Now, for our second presentation, I would like to invite Justin Sycamore from Justin Sycamore DDS, Carlos Bailey from Swiss Re Group, Tyson Marshall and Shannon Gostin. My apologies if I mispronounce your name, from, is it Rind Print? Thank you, to join me. Tonight, we are very pleased to recognize these three local businesses which have completed the city's Green Business Certification Program. I'd also like to introduce Rod Cordova from our Public Works Department, and he is the one who will explain this very important program, and he will also tell us more about these three environmentally conscious local businesses. Where are you? Right behind me? Okay, here you go.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. The Green Business Certification Program recognizes and rewards small and medium-sized businesses that demonstrate a purposeful commitment to environmental stewardship through solid waste reduction, recycling, energy and water conservation, pollution prevention. Green Business Certification is one of the best ways to lower costs, generate growth, increase employee engagement, and provide a competitive edge within the eco-conscious Thousand Oaks community. These three businesses have completed a checklist of items required to achieve certified status. Justin Sycamore, DDS. Justin owns and operates a paperless dental office with patient files stored digitally rather than using paper charts. They use digital x-ray equipment, which avoids the use of toxic developing chemicals. In the office, they've replaced all fluorescent T12 lighting with LED lights. They installed a dry vacuum system, which does not use any water. And they also hand water outside plants rather than using irrigation. Rind Print. Rind Print has been providing labels and flexible packaging folding cartons for over 30 years. They have implemented a system where all computers are taken home each day, reducing redundancies in equipment and reducing energy use. They have paperless PDF invoicing and proofing, eliminating paper waste, and mailing resources. They also have an on-demand hot water system, and they keep their light use to a minimum. The Swiss Re Group is a leading global wholesale provider of insurance products and services. Every Swiss Re location is responsible for managing its environmental footprint. The local location here in Thousand Oaks leases its space in a LEED-certified building. Guided by Swiss Re's global sustainability and policy framework, the office focuses on controlling environmental impacts in energy, travel, paper, procurement, supplier management, waste, and recycling. Congratulations to our newest green certified businesses.
And by the way, this plaque is made of 100% recycled glass with blue pine recycled wood.
As it should be.
As it should be.
Thank you.
Congratulations. And to you.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. Would you like to say a few words? It's up to you. You don't have to. You don't want to. Go ahead. Thank you. Yeah, we can do that.
I'm very excited to be before the City Council tonight. I would like to thank Rod and Vanessa from the Sustainability Division of Public Works for helping me through the certification process. When I first applied, there was no green business program for dental offices in place, and they were great in developing it and expanding the number of businesses that can qualify to be certified green. I grew up in Thousand Oaks, but it wasn't until I moved away and lived in other cities like Los Angeles, Miami, and New York City that I really realized how special a place that Thousand Oaks is. I love living here and hope that my daughter will grow up and want to live here too. It's our responsibility as business owners and leaders of the community to keep Thousand Oaks beautiful and vibrant. That's why the Green Business Program is so important. Conserving water and electricity, as well as responsibly recycling and disposing of waste, is everyone's responsibility, but I think local business should be held to a higher standard, as they are a big part of what gives a city its identity. When I built out my office, it was my goal to make it beautiful and comfortable, but I also wanted to make it green. Throughout the whole construction process, we looked for ways to conserve. We changed all the lighting to LED and installed skylights and windows. We installed a new ultra-high efficiency HVAC system. We installed new plumbing fixtures that are all California certified green and will save thousands of gallons of water over their lifetime. We're a digital office, so we really minimize the amount of paper waste. In fact, since we've opened about a year and a half ago, we're only halfway through our second ream of paper. I'm proud of my efforts that we've made, but I will continue to evaluate my dental practice and look for ways that I can do it and make a bigger difference in being green and conscious of the environment. Thank you to the City Council for helping to make Thousand Oaks beautiful and encouraging businesses to be green.
Halfway through the second ream of paper, that is just, I can't put my head around that or wrap my head around that. All right, that's amazing. Now, I would like to ask the City of Thousand Oaks Public Works Director, Jay Spurgeon, to come to the podium, and you are here. So May 21st through the 27th, we have National Public Works Week. And this year's theme is Public Works Connects Us. And I believe everyone here would agree that the city's Public Works Department does a remarkable job of keeping our city connected. Public Works, yes, maintains the city's infrastructure and manages the city's water distribution, wastewater collection, fleet services, landscaping, graffiti removal, storm drain maintenance, street repair, public transit, street traffic and safety. They also provide 24-hour emergency response services. All of these undertakings are a vital and essential part of everyday life in Thousand Oaks. The health, safety, and welfare of our community greatly depend on the men and women of Public Works. And as part of Public Works Week, the Municipal Service Center hosts an open house to highlight the services provided by Public Works. We encourage Thousand Oaks residents to visit and learn about the great work that they do. So, Jay, would you please accept this commendation and proclamation, actually, to you, your department, the men and women, and of course, please tell us even more about the wonderful things you do. Mm. Here you go.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor and Council. And we are, as we have for many years, we'll be hosting an open house on May 23rd and 24th, as the mayor mentioned. We do invite the public to sign up for tours. We expect, again, this year, over 1,000 school children and interested adults to come out, where we can show them, give them an inside peek at all the cool stuff that we do in public works to keep the city running and all the various areas that the mayor mentioned. So to sign up, you can go online. You can send us an email at publicworksmsc@teoaks.org or give us a call at 449-2499. The Municipal Service Center is located at 1993 Rancho Cuneo Boulevard in the Newbury Park area. So again, to sign up for a tour, give us an email, drop us an email, publicworksmsc@teoaks.org or call 449-2499, and we hope to see you out there. And thank you, Mayor, for the recognition.
I remember when I chaperoned my, I believe, third grade class to the Municipal Service Center. The kids had such a blast. It was absolutely fantastic. They learned so much. Now, I would like to invite David Deutsch, the Executive Director of the National Alliance on Mental Illness, Ventura County, to come to the podium. Tonight, we officially recognize May as Mental Health Month with a proclamation from the city. Each year, millions of Americans, including one in four adults and one in five children, face the reality of living with a mental health condition. Many more people are affected indirectly through family, friends, neighbors, and coworkers. Mental illness includes major depression, bipolar disorder, and post-traumatic stress disorder, among others. These illnesses are highly treatable, yet many people are discouraged from seeking treatment because of social stigmas and misunderstanding. Therefore, the City of Thousand Oaks proclaims May 2017 as Mental Health Month in order to raise community awareness of this very important health issue. And David is here tonight to tell us more about the organization and the work that he is doing for Mental Health Month. Good evening.
Thank you so much, Madam Mayor, council members. National Alliance on Mental Illness, of which NAMI Ventura County is our local affiliate, is the largest organization in the United States that advocates for services for persons impacted by mental illness, not only the person who has a diagnosis, but for friends, family members, and other people that they are close to. We offer a wide range of classes, programs, and services and support groups throughout Ventura County. We make presentations at the high school level, college level, and community in community settings, as well as in faith-based settings. We are very involved in efforts to advocate for legislation that supports services for those who have mental illness, and we provide all of our services and all of our programs at no cost to anybody at any time. The reason that we are able to do this is because we have an annual fundraiser, which this year takes place on Saturday, May 6th, 11 days from today. It is our annual NAMI Walk, which takes place at the Ventura Beach Promenade, starting at 10 in the morning. It's an event that was attended by about 1,500 people last year. We have people who themselves have a diagnosis come to the event. We have family members. We have many, many people in the provider community and many concerned citizens. It also raises awareness about mental illness, as well as raising more than 50% of our annual revenue. In addition to that, it's a fun event. It winds along the beach path along Surfers Point, goes inland, turns around, and comes back. People bring their children. We have face painting for kids. We have art exhibits. People bring their dog. Sometimes my wife would bring our little dog and dress her up. Although now we have a new puppy who barks at everybody, so she probably won't bring the dogs this year. But it's a great event. We would encourage you to come out. There are over 60 teams already formed. We expect more teams to be formed. There are 55 sponsors as of date who help with the event. We are grateful for the community we support that we receive from all areas of Ventura County. There are several sponsorship organizations in Thousand Oaks, and we are very, very grateful for that. I started my work in this field about 13 years ago at Lutheran Social Services down the street here on Hillcrest, and I've worked in the field of mental health treatment continuously for the last 13 years in Ventura County. I appreciate so much having the opportunity to have the time with you tonight, and we're very honored to accept this proclamation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I have a picture taken.
Thank you. And it is indeed a wonderful walk in Ventura along the beach, just a couple of miles or so, not quite. If the weather complies, it's something that you will enjoy very much. Finally, tonight, I'd like to invite someone whom my own children, my 11-year-old twins, have been watching religiously on television. He is Cole Frederickson. And I would like to invite Cole to the podium. He is 12 years old. Why don't you come on down, Cole? I'll tell you why he's here and why Cole is a big deal. Cole is 12. He attends Ascension Lutheran School here in Thousand Oaks, and some of you might recognize him as a recent contestant and semi-finalist on the Food Network's Kids Baking Championship, where he made it to the final four. Yay! Cole has been baking since he was 2 years old, according to celebrity chef Duff Goldman, and has become an impressive baker. Well, we know that. We saw everything you created on television. It was quite incredible. Cole is known for his ability to decorate and plate his creations, and especially for his favorite homemade chocolate cake. And just to give you a little taste, we have a video to show you.
Who will bake their way to $25,000?
Hallelujah!
Yeah!
And become the kids' baking champion.
Any idea what it might be?
Dessert and lobster!
You will have 90 minutes to bake and decorate 1 dozen sugar cookies. You have 2 hours to make a tie-dye cake.
That looks spectacular.
That is a moist
cake. Super moist.
Thank you.
Cupcakes? Piece of cake. Literally.
My name is Cole. I'm 12 years old, and I'm the best baker in America. I'm completely self-taught. I love to eat my food. That just kind of encourages me to make more.
Today I'm gonna make maple bacon donuts.
I want to smoke my coconut for my coconut cream pie because my dad likes to smoke everything.
I want my cupcakes to stand out. So I decided I'm going to paint streaks of dye into my piping bag and then add my frosting to give that lollipop look.
Yes! It's awesome!
I'm going to make an easy chocolate cake with a strawberry coulis. But I don't want it to be boring, so I'm going to infuse it with coffee.
I'm dipping each cookie in a lemon rose water glaze, and then I'm just gonna airbrush and then do decorations on top of that.
My donuts are cooled, and I'll dunk it in the maple glaze and sprinkle some good bacon on there.
I'm making a yellow cake with root beer buttercream. I'm gonna torch these marshmallows and airbrush them to the perfect popcorn color. It's chocolate cake infused with coffee with a pecan topping for like meat texture. And the mashed potatoes are a banana buttercream with a candy melt butter square. So it's an eclair filled with coconut cream pie filling and whipped cream. dipped in ganache and graham crackers with hickory smoked coconut. It's a yellow cake stuffed with a deep fried sandwich cookie with root beer buttercream, topped with a deep fried sandwich cookie, cotton candy, and marshmallow popcorn.
Cole, I love the way that these are decorated.
Absolutely. I gotta tell you, it's incredibly impressive looking. Really impressive looking.
Great, sweet, and salty. Mm-hmm. You know, real nice. I think the chocolate is the star.
Yeah, the cranberry, love it with the chocolate. I love the bacon and the maple together. I love the glaze. It's delicious. Mmm.
Cake's real nice. I mean, it's like a, you know, good deep chocolate flavor. Mm-hmm. I think you used the coffee right.
Really, well done.
Thank you.
Cole.
Yes.
Your meatloaf and mashed potatoes were amazing. You hit every detail. Excellent work.
He's so talented.
Can you imagine this? Is your mouth watering yet? Well, Cole, I have to say, we watched you every time. Of course, we think you should have won. To us, you were the big, big winner. And you actually helped Thousand Oaks be put on the map. And we're just so very happy that you had a chance to represent not only your incredible baking talents and skills, but your school, Essential Lutheran, as well as the city of Thousand Oaks. So we are very, very happy for you to have made it so far. And we are also grateful for being here tonight with your family. And we would like to present you with this certificate from the city congratulating you on your incredible achievement. And it says, certificate of congratulations presented to Cole Frederickson for making it to the final four on the Food Channel's Kids Baking Championship and consistently baking incredible desserts the entire season. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Are you good? Okay, very good. You're going to have a picture taken.
He was just teasing us the whole time.
So much, appreciate it. I was hoping you would tell us what your next chapter is, or the next step, whether you will continue baking. Yes, we hope so. We hope so. Very, very good. Before you leave, we have to take more pictures, especially with two of your fans sitting here. Right here. All right. So now this really concludes our special presentations for the evening, and I will move back to my seat and continue with the rest of the agenda. All right. Now, next up on the agenda, we have public comments. Madam Clerk?
This is a time and place for public comments. A speaker card is available for those wishing to address the City Council regarding items on the agenda or on a subject within the city's jurisdiction. Speakers for public hearing items shall be called and heard during the public hearing. All remarks should be addressed to the council as a whole, and all documents for the city council and the official record should be presented to the city clerk prior to speaking. Speakers are requested to state their name and community of residence for the record. Under state law, public comment matters may not be considered by the council unless listed on the agenda, but may be referred to the city manager for administrative follow-up. Three individuals have presented cards, and pursuant to council standards, speakers are allowed 3 minutes. The yellow light displays when you have 1 minute remaining.
Thank you. And our first speaker is Carolyn Guillot, followed by Nick Kidwai and Tom Hunt.
Thank you, Mayor. My name's Carolyn Guillot from Thousand Oaks. Council members, I'd like to speak tonight about free stuff. We all like free stuff. Everyone here likes free stuff. For city councils, free stuff has a double purpose. It can help them with their budget shortfalls, which you've been talking about a lot lately. And at the same time, it can help them win support with their constituents. It can be used to show that they want to help the people they represent. But free stuff from governments has strings attached. So what I want to say tonight is beware, because there is a new twist with free stuff in a new HUD ruling from the Federal Housing and Urban Development Department. It's called Affirmatively Furthering Fair Housing, referred to as AFFH. AFFH requires communities that apply for HUD grants to strip search every neighborhood, detailing income level, religion, race, and national origin of every single person living there. HUD has created specific guidelines dictating specific numbers of each for a proper balance. If there are any shortages in any of the categories, then the neighborhood is deemed to be out of balance. HUD then requires that the community correct the situation. That correction requires communities to unnecessarily spend millions of tax dollars. To impose AFFH, HUD has changed tactics that are catching unaware local officials by surprise. How? That HUD grants come with severe strings attached. Local officials have routinely sought and accepted HUD grants, declaring them as free money for local development. There used to be at least a pretense of local control. No more. HUD is now employing a stronger legal enforcement mechanism, seldom used before, to strictly enforce those attached and hidden strings. The result is social engineering that is leading to the destruction of property values and property rights of neighborhoods. In addition, any local governing body that takes a HUD grant now finds that their ability to govern the community as they were elected to do is basically gone, as HUD bureaucrats dictate policy. HUD has already filed legal actions against communities such as Westchester County, New York, and Marin County, California, for attempting to stand up to the HUD rules. Meanwhile, Baltimore, Maryland has been forced to spend $30 million over the next 10 years to build 1,000 low-income homes in affluent neighborhoods. Such threats are growing across the nation.
Mrs. Guillot, your time is up.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nick Kidwai, followed by Tom Hunt.
I begin in the name of God, who's most beneficial, most merciful. My name is Nick Iqbal Kidwai. I'm a resident of Newbury Park since 79 and director of Concerned Citizens Thousand Oaks. I'm sporting my council tie openly today with no jacket. Unfortunately, I've had it for 11 years and doesn't seem to be retiring. So not a good symbol, though. I don't know how many of you watched last night's Planning Commission meeting. It was in kind of my neighborhood in Newbury Park. Car wash had been proposed in a quiet neighborhood. And the sad thing is that there was a 5-0 vote against the interests of the residents. Many people have moved here because of the quality of life and the higher standards that we have, but unfortunately they are slipping like a slide, very bad. There were at least two findings a non-lawyer like me could find. One was that because it was not meeting all the codes like Lupes did, which was a horrible project that was approved, but the excuse was that it met all the boulevard guidelines. There was a setback requirement that was waived, as well as sound mitigation. I mean, sound levels are just way too high. The good news is that there is still time, 9 days, to file an appeal by the residents. Unfortunately, the city has raised so much, and the mayor doesn't do anything about it. It was $500 before. It's $1,500, so it becomes difficult for residents to raise that kind of money. It's pocket change for people who profit off the city council, and there's no citizens here because none of those projects are on today, but they are ready to grease the skids all the time. Unfortunately, we heard at the national level about draining the swamp, and the swamp is being filled up there, and it's overflowing in this city, unfortunately. There was a picture of a councilman in a city. You don't have to go to Egypt to take a picture at the Auto Mall in front of the pyramids of Egypt. There's two pyramids where the Cadillac dealer used to be. It's a Silver Star. It's been there for months. This council has no business. That's why the agendas are so skinny. The reason is that a lot of these important things are being done in the basement, away from the public. That's what it is. It's the honest truth. One of the bad things that the federal government is doing, the CDBG grant may have some social implications, but in this city, the CDBG grant helps hundreds of thousands of people, and I would ask the city council that you should lobby strongly in order to save this money for our residents.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai. Our last speaker, Mr. Price has a question.
Just wanted to let you know, Mr. Kidwai, the mayor and I spent some time back in D.C. here just last month and did, in fact, do just that, lobbied very strongly to maintain CDBG funding.
Thank you so much, Councilman.
And I also signed a petition by the United Conference of Mayors to appeal to the White House to not to slash CDBG funding, as a matter of fact. All right, Mr. Tom Hunt.
Okay, Madam Mayor and Council, first of all, I want to update you on something I brought up about 4 months ago when you installed that arrow on the on-ramp going to Ventura on Lynn Road. I live in the Los Orbis Homeowners Association, right on the corner of Green Meadow there. And all the people that live there have made comments on how happy they are, and I know it saved a lot of lives. So I really want to thank you again for putting that up there. But there's one area there that we're having a problem with. When the people get off the freeway and head west on Lynn Road, by the time they hit Green Meadow, they're doing about 70 miles an hour. And I'm just wondering if it would be possible to put one of those monitors on the street there. I got a sore throat. Where it would monitor to show how fast they're going, because the speed limit is 50. But when they hit that red light there, and it's just turning, they're doing 65, 70, a lot of them. So I think it would be advantageous if we could at least put a monitor there to let them know how fast they're going before they get to that light. So I thank you.
Thank you. The city manager will address that. Mr. Powers?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I've asked Police Chief Tim Hagel if he doesn't mind stepping out, and he'll chat with you about that. I'm certainly confident that we can do something in regards to that. He's going to come down right now.
All right. That concludes public comments. And we now go to our consent calendar. Anybody would anybody like to pull something? Mr. Price? No? I see your name here. Okay. Anything? Nothing? Okay, before we do a motion, I do have a speaker, and that is Mr. Kidwai.
Nick Iqbal Kidwai, resident of Newbury Park, director of Concerned Citizens of Thousand Oaks, Honorable Mayor Council. First of all, I'd like to mention something which is not on the consent agenda, which is the Cal-Am legal funding. I know you're supposed to talk about the consent, but it is related in that the consent calendar, my concern over the years has been and still is that too many things that are important are put on the consent calendar. They're not put on the regular agenda so that people and taxpayers are fully aware of it. And I believe tonight the reason that $60,000 for Cal-Am is not on the consent is because really there should really be no meeting. because there's only the user item, and nothing. So this council has become a do-nothing council now, because there's hardly any business that comes that is debatable. That's why the minutes are so important, which is number B. And right now, we are going into a conflict with North Korea. And I believe the leader there, if he saw these minutes, he would issue a commendation to you folks. Because, yeah, it's very funny. It's very funny that the building blocks of democracy are being destroyed slowly. Yes, sir. In fact, big business is in cahoots with the government. And Microsoft charges $286,000 of user fees. I mean, you know, 20 years ago, and I've been coming here since 25 years, there was no PC, no Microsoft, anything. These are the kind of overheads that are eating away at the quality of life, and this money does not, it's not funny money that's being paid to Microsoft. And everybody's quiet about it. You know, individually, a lot of people make copies illegally, but government or even companies cannot do that. And this is kind of, you know, holding up the taxpayers in the back door. Same thing, instead of spending money on good things like street cleaning or pothole repair, $185,000 is going for security guards. I mean, protecting us from us. And I told some of the people that, well, you can come to the council and there's no metal check or anything at all. And they said, what, really? How can they do that? I mean, we really don't need it. If one crazy guy or woman once does that, it will be dealt. But to subject everybody to these things, and a lot of the security expenditures in the city shot up because there was free money available, like the speaker said before, because the government was giving after 9/11 several billion dollars to beef up. So that's why so many cameras have been put up. But then after that, you have to maintain it, which is not paid for. I guess I'm out of time.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai. I will pull, for housekeeping reasons, 7I. And Mr. Price.
I would move the balance of the consent calendar then, excluding 7I.
Please vote.
That motion carries 4-0.
Mayor Pro Tem Fox absent. Okay. And I'm pulling 7I because we had Mr. Councilmember McCoy absent, and then you can just abstain from voting on that particular item. Again, that's just for housekeeping purposes. Let's see who would like to make the motion. Mr. Price.
I'll make the motion to move 7I.
Thank you. Please vote.
That motion carries 3-0 with Councilmember McCoy abstaining. And I have an ordinance title to read. Ordinance amending Municipal Code Title 7, Chapter 2, Article 9 concerning landscaping and public rights of way, MCA 2016-70410. The applicant is City of Thousand Oaks, Ordinance 1630-NS.
Thank you. And now to our first public hearing, well, the only one really, that is the proposed citywide user fees. Madam Clerk, can you please open that hearing?
Hearing advertised as required by law is open to consider agenda item 8A regarding proposed 2017 citywide user fees, fines, penalties, rates, and assessments, user fees, traffic development impact fees, and police facilities development fee. A speaker card is available for those wishing to address the City Council regarding this public hearing. All documents for City Council and the official city record should be presented to the City Clerk prior to speaking. Speaker cards are requested to state their name and community of residence for the record. We have one individual who has presented a speaker card and will have 5 minutes. The yellow light will display when you have 1 minute remaining.
Thank you. And we will start out the presentation with our finance director, Mr. John Adams. Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Mayor, City Council. So tonight we're having a public hearing on the annual the biannual adoption of our user fees, fines, penalties, impact fees. So just briefly, I'm going to give a brief presentation, background and history, make a few highlights, and then the staff recommendation. Staff will be available for any questions, and then, of course, public comment, and then City Council deliberation and adoption. So just some background. The last time that the council actually adopted user fees was back in April of 2015. This year in February, towards the end of the month in February, you had a study session in which we provided a comprehensive review of all fees that the city has and that are proposed to increase July 1st. Tonight is the public hearing, and then as you adopt those fees, the fees will go into effect July 1st. So the manual that was handed out is more than just user fees. There's actually assessments, fines, rates, and penalties in that book. This does cover all major departments within the city, so city clerk, finance, cultural affairs, library, police, public works, and community development. Multiple types of fees, development-related fees, mainly building and safety, engineering, and planning. Selected fees were adjusted by CPI. There were some selected fees that were increased higher, 5% or higher, to get them closer to cost recovery. Non-development related fees, things that are in finance or city clerk, which are based on time and materials, were adjusted by CPI. Development impact fees related to public works and traffic, there is no adjustments. There are nexus studies that are being performed currently and will be back in front of the council later this year. The police facility fee, which is a development impact fee, is being adjusted a little over 1%. And as far as water and wastewater rates, those are going to return to the city council later this summer. Just quickly, what is a fee? It is a charge to an individual group that receives a private benefit. It's not a tax, it's not an impact fee, and there are gray areas. Just to give you an example, 100% private benefit would be a building permit. They would pay the full cost of that fee. Public benefit would be a recreation program or a library program. Some private benefit, advanced planning, and then public benefit, police services. So state law more or less suggests that we cannot recover any more than what it costs to provide the fee or the service to provide the fee to provide the service. Council policy, which is adopted many, many years ago, more or less says that for community-wide benefit that they'll adjust fees accordingly, that the use of general purpose revenues will be appropriate when those fees have public benefit. But in absence of that, fees will be adopted at full cost recovery. So one of the questions that occurred at the study session was related to cost recovery. And this is one of the areas in which we have a lot of fees related to building and safety, planning, engineering, and code enforcement. The last time the city did a cost of service study was 2013 in these areas, and the fees were adjusted then. The first column shows you what the full cost of providing those services were. Now, when we go and look at full costs, we anticipate not just the direct, but also the indirect costs. So the indirect costs would be overhead like building, could be finance department, could be city manager's office. What we show in columns 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 is the actual revenues received during those years with the percentage of full cost recovery. The one unique variable to all of this is that it's based on activity. We cannot predict what the activity levels will be, and thus revenues will fluctuate over time. For building and safety engineering and code, those fees are really set to recover full cost recovery, just dependent on activity. Planning does not normally meet that criteria as far as full cost recovery and is really based on activity. So, you know, if there's any questions, I can answer them at the end of the presentation. This was sort of highlighted in the staff report just to give you a sense of where cost recovery is in these major areas. In the book that was provided to the council, there's really three sections. The first section is the detailed sheets, provides you all the detail and What's the basis for the fee? Second section is Yellow Pages, shows you the difference between the adopted fee currently and the proposed fee. And then the third section is fees related to non-compliance, people that are coming in after the fact and getting permits. So the one good thing is there has been no changes from to fees since the study session that was in February. In past years, we usually do make some changes based on either council feedback or just as we go through and do our due diligence and review, we've made some adjustments. This year, there have been no adjustments based on the study session. So tonight, we just have three quick recommendations. One is to adopt the resolution approving the citywide fees, adopt a resolution maintaining traffic development impact fees, and adopt a resolution approving police facilities fees. And with that, staff is available for any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Adams.
You're welcome.
Mr. Adam, no S.
Thank you, Mayor. Hi, John. Good job.
Good evening.
As usual. So the city offers a tremendous amount of services to its residents, everything from street maintenance to the city clerk department, to the police department. It's millions of dollars worth of services. We also have enterprises that we operate. For example, the golf course, the theaters that we sit in. Those are other services or enterprises, you could say, that we offer. And naturally, all these services and enterprises cost money to run. And that's why we're here tonight, because the fees that our residents are paying pay for these services. But the key thing, takeaway to remember, is that the city cannot, by law, charge anything more than what it costs to deliver these services. Isn't that correct?
That is correct.
Anything beyond that would be a tax, and we don't do it.
Correct, it would be illegal. That is correct.
That's right. That's right. So there's nothing that we recover more than what it costs to deliver these services. And it's been the policy of the council to try to get full cost recovery on these services, and we're doing that in most areas. One area that we don't get full cost recovery would be planning, but if I'm, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if I'm not mistaken, probably the biggest beneficiary of that would be the homeowners of Thousand Oaks.
The community as a whole, that is correct.
Right, the community as a whole. So meaning that if you want to put an extra bedroom on your house or remodel the kitchen, you're gonna get a break when you come to City Hall and go to our planning department. So it'll be the homeowners that are the beneficiaries of that.
That would be correct.
I think that's good. I'm sure the homeowners do as well. And the other quick question I had, and I mentioned the enterprises that we're involved in, the golf course, the wastewater treatment plant, the theaters that we sit in now. Our policy there is, of course, is to charge enough to cover our costs. But that's seen as a little different, is it not?
It is. Enterprise funds really operate as their own business enterprises, right? I mean, water and wastewater, we do very comprehensive financial plans every 2 years, which help develop those rates. Public Works does a tremendous job in that aspect of projecting out not just the operating costs, but really the capital costs related to maintain the infrastructure. And so very much more complicated in developing those fees. But again, you're providing a direct service, whether it's water and wastewater, and those need to be cost recovery. They cannot be supported by the general fund, right, or general taxes.
And that's what's happening. We are achieving full cost recovery on our enterprises, are we not?
That is correct. There is no water, wastewater, the theaters fund, and the golf course do not provide or not receive any subsidies from the general fund in that aspect. And I think, as you know, being on the theaters budget committee, it was very difficult to figure out how to resolve that. And I think Barry's done a great job in developing fees that hopefully will make that sustainable long-term.
Yes. So our enterprises are supporting themselves.
That is
the theaters, the golf course. We have six enterprises total, wastewater facility and a few others. They're supporting themselves, and homeowners can get a break here at the city if they want to remodel their house, for example.
Yes.
Ultimately.
Well, we're providing the service for less than it costs to provide it.
Right. All right. Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Okay. We do have one speaker on this item, Mr. Kidwai.
Good
Nick Kidwai, resident of Newbury Park, director concerned city in Thousand Oaks. Good, this is a public hearing, so it's 5 minutes. You should really change the 3 minute rule. I mean, there's no crowds anymore. And people who have nothing to say cannot speak for 5 minutes. I sent, I wrote something earlier on in this, and it's in the green packet. For those people who do not know what a green packet is, it's go on the website and go on the agenda, and it should be, and they are even archived. So if you read these kind of things, you'll be in tears because it's very sad. The state of affairs of the government, if I might say so. I should be positive, but very difficult. Due to family and work constraints, we could not, concerned citizens could not provide input earlier. There should be a comparison, 5 year, 10 year, 15 year, of the rates of the user fees in graphic form so that you can see where this is headed to. I went out, I have the user manual from 2003 and others, and I was going to make comparisons. And part of the thing is, I mean, I don't know if it is because of me that this is here, because at the study session, there was no hard copy. You should have two hard copies over here, so that if somebody has it, like I have it right now, somebody else can peruse it. And you have a very good printing press and all that, so it doesn't cost that much. But these PDF files on the web, it's 468 pages or something like that for the user thing. They're not easy to navigate. One of the problems is the search feature, which, I mean, these old-fashioned tabs, I mean, you can't beat it. I mean, so the web is good for certain things, but not for everything. I think the Newbury Park Library is being shortchanged again and not being provided these things because, at least for something else, I did read, or maybe it was for this, that the books are available at TO Library. And the whole reason for Newbury Park Library existed was to make it more local, even though it's not such a long drive. And the thing is that if you go to one library, you don't want to go to another library for just one little thing. I don't know if this will be answered. I know, in fact, the staff grind their teeth because the city council is not interested in my input or maybe other citizens' input, is that how is the cost of recovery figured out? And that's the thing about the accountant's dilemma, is that direct costs, everybody knows what the cost is, but how is the overhead put up? How are the $200,000 club that we have of the executive team, all the salaries, and now the growing retirement load that the city has, all that is figured into the cost recovery, or not? I mean, what is the methodology? I mean, Mr. Adam gives wonderful presentations, thanks to Microsoft, over the years, but these are the issues that maybe you should dwell in. Like, what is missing? I mean, looked in the police section, but when we had the Great Depression in 2009, Mitnick canceled the it's called City Night Out, I believe. It is one of the best things that you can do, $10,000, a bang for the money, where the citizens are involved, the fire department, in fact, Supervisor Parks even sat in one of them. They go to the 26 neighborhoods in the city, and with the fire truck, with the fire engines, to get the community involved to prevent crime. That's what has made us number one. Simi Valley has not cut it. Oxnard has the biggest night out ever. Read it in the Star. That's what I have done. And so it's about time that some of these things should come back when we are getting the extra sales tax now. And I do appreciate, and other people will too, that you have made the change to give the money for the road maintenance, which has been negative in the past. So I thank you. I thank the staff for working hard, especially the people that work behind the scenes. It's not a one man or two person. There's a young lady that works in the department that is very good. Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai. Okay, so are there any other questions of staff? Would you like to respond to some of the comments made, Mr. Adams?
Yes, I'd at least like to, as Mr. Kidway suggested, thank staff. There's a lot of staff throughout all departments that do a lot of work, and I actually do the easy part, I actually come up and make the presentation, so that's the easy part for me. You know, the comment related to showing a graph showing changes in fees over 10 to 15 years, certainly I appreciate the feedback, and maybe during the next presentation we do on user fees, we will include that, because I do think it's valuable to see how fees have changed over time. Most fees we adjust with CPI until we do a full cost full cost study, and then we adjust them more. But what it will show you is fees mostly are raised with a CPI. You know, the other comment related to indirect overhead. The city does prepare annually a full cost allocation plan. And because we have enterprise funds that are running like businesses and are getting provided support from government internal services like finance and city attorney's office, there is a methodology in which we do every year that allocates those internal service support functions to those enterprise funds or to those fees. So it's very consistent across the board. It's through best practices that we do this. Certainly, staff would, you know, at the direction of the council, would show the full costs plan, which is as big as the user fee book. And I'm not sure it may even be posted on our website, but we do an annual cost allocation plan that shows those indirect costs. So with that, I'm available for any other questions.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. If there are no further questions, then I'm looking for a motion to adopt all three resolutions. And Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, it's a monumental effort to go through hundreds, if not thousands, of these user fees. So thank you, John. I know that takes a lot of time for you and your staff. And with that, I will move the adoption of the 2017 user fees along with staff's recommendation on traffic and police development fees.
Thank you. We do have a motion. And yes, I would like to thank staff and the finance department for putting all of this together. Not an easy task. Madam Clerk, can you please prepare us for a vote? Thank you.
That motion carries 4-0 with Councilmember Fox being absent.
Thank you. All right, now, the next item is a department report. It deals with the legal services by the city to fight a proposed water increase or rate increase by California American Water Company. And that department report will be presented by our Public Works Director, Mr. Jay Spurgeon.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and Council. As you know, California American Water Company is one of four different water providers within the city of Thousand Oaks. The city water system, or the city water division, the California Water Service Company, and Camarosa Water District are the others. Last year, Cal-Am filed with the California Public Utility Commission an application to increase its rates as well as consolidate the Thousand Oaks service area with four other service areas throughout Southern California. That proposed rate increase would total, when you add in the costs of imported water, over 40% covering the next 3 years. That is a significant impact to our residents who are within the Cal-Am Water Service Area, as well as businesses and the city itself and the Canary Recreation and Park District as well. So because of those impacts, the city petitioned and was granted party status in this case, which gives us really a greater say in how the proceedings go forward. And also, the city council on January 24th approved retaining an outside counsel of a firm, Downey Brand LLP from Sacramento, who are really experts in PUC rate cases. So our outside attorneys have been helping us along the way. They have assisted staff in preparing a testimony over 100 pages, which was submitted in February. This provides detailed argument against and opposing their consolidation, as well as the huge rate increases. We've also submitted rebuttal testimony. Over time, it has become very apparent that this case is much more complicated and requires quite a bit more time than we had initially anticipated. There have been literally thousands of pages of testimony from other, from CalAmp itself, from the PUC's Office of Ratepayer Advocates, and other parties to the case. We have made a difference, I think. Actually, I know. Last week, we were contacted by CalAmp. They wanted to sit down with us and discuss a settlement. No other party in this case, including the PUC's Office of Ratepayer Advocates, really put up much of an argument or presented any facts to challenge their consolidation and their high rates, just the City of Thousand Oaks. And CalAmp would not have wanted to sit down and talk settlement if, in fact, I think we had not been involved in this case. Now, the PUC has very strict confidentiality rules about settlement discussions. So the details of our meeting yesterday, which I attended in Sacramento with our attorney and CalAmp representatives, we will be discussing in closed session at the end of the meeting. Should the settlement agreement be approved by the PUC, then, of course, the details will be available to the public. So we are asking council tonight to, with this item, to authorize an additional $60,000 for our attorneys to continue to help us through this case, bringing the total to $160,000. There is considerable more effort yet to come. In addition to continuing to negotiate this settlement agreement, there are hearings that begin next week. The attorneys will need to attend those hearings. I will be attending those hearings eventually in San Francisco to testify on behalf of the city and our residents. There's cross-examination. Anyway, suffice it to say, there's still a lot of work. And again, I really believe that our efforts have borne fruit. Remember, what's at stake here is not only 18,000 of city residents who are CalAmp customers, who collectively, should their proposed rate increase be approved, would be spending over $4 million per year more for water than they are today. But also the city and the park district, we would potentially be spending $200,000 to $300,000 more per year each for water in the service area, again, should their rate proposal go through. So there's a lot at stake. And I would ask you to approve this additional authorization. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Spurgeon. And Mr. Price has a question.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. You mentioned 18,000 residents. Is that the number of individual homes, not the number of individual people?
Thank you. That's not the population. That's okay. The number of customers. So that would be the number of single-family homes. Okay. And then there's, in addition to that, probably another couple thousand, 3,000 commercial, industrial, and public customers.
And that doesn't include the folks who might live in an unincorporated area that is serviced by CalAmp, but are adjacent to Thousand Oaks.
The 18,000 does include.
It does include, okay,
those customers.
So
yes.
You mentioned that there are four service areas that are being impacted. Are they? Have any of those other service areas or any of the cities or been given part or class status as we have? Are they engaged in the battle?
Well, the city certainly has party status, and of course the Office of Ratepayer Advocates is always a party to any case. I believe that the City of Coronado and the County of Los Angeles also petitioned for and were granted party status. So there's two others besides the city.
So then I would assume that they are doing everything that we're doing at the same time that we're doing it to get this worked out, if you will, to protect their residents.
I would say that they are to a degree. For instance, the County of LA's testimony that they submitted was two or three pages in total. Coronado's, again, they were actually not opposing the consolidation for reasons that we talked about before, but some of these districts, some of these service areas with consolidation actually would see a lower rate increase than if they remained standalone. So they would presumably be supportive of a consolidation.
And Thousand Oaks would be the most adversely impacted, disproportionately impacted by this consolidation. Wasn't that what I recall from the original?
Yes, that is correct. So with the expected imported water increases, which are added to what they would get as far as the increases, the consolidation proposal is over 40%, and standalone would be about 24%, perhaps, something like that. Okay. So considerably less.
Well, thank you. If there aren't any other questions, I'll wait. I'm willing to make a motion.
I do have a question. The $160,000 that we might authorize spending on this case sounds like a lot of money, and I know that the Park District pledged $25,000, and a request by two county supervisors, our supervisor in District 2, Linda Parks, as well as Supervisor Kelly Long, attempted to get their colleagues to share in the cost as well, but unfortunately that did not prevail. So the question I have, $160,000, can you put that in perspective overall in terms of, is it worth spending that much in taxpayer dollars to save water rates for 20,000 or so? From a staff perspective, we all have our own opinions.
Sure.
Up here, but yeah.
Of course. Well, I can wholeheartedly say absolutely it's worth it. And again, if you just think of the impacts from 1 year of CalAmm's proposed, what they're asking for, the over 40%, the difference between that and what the standalone proposal would be, which I think is still high, 24%, but that difference is $4.5 million to our residents, and that isn't even, and that estimate doesn't even include the cost of businesses, but it does include the impacts to the city and the park district, which could be $500,000 a year. So I think this is well worth it. And again, I think if we were not involved, this would there would be really nobody to challenge it, and really looking out certainly for our residents.
So these $160,000 are the proverbial drop in the bucket then in the overall picture, right? Okay. I believe that Mr. Powers would like to make a few comments.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I just want to make a quick statement and thanks to Public Works Director Jay Spurgeon. There are few agencies in the state that have someone of Jay's caliber on this issue in particular, and the fact that he is serving as our expert on this case is actually saving the city money. And he flew up to Sacramento yesterday, up and back same day on short notice to represent our residents. I just want to say a quick note of thanks to Jay for his hours and hours of work that he's put into this.
Thank you. All right. Then if there are no further questions, I'm looking for a motion. You were? Okay, I didn't see. Let's see. That is you, Joel Price.
Thank you. I also want to say that Jay actually attended the PUC hearing that was held several months ago at the Palm Garden Hotel, and they literally wanted to carry him out on their shoulders. He was the voice of reason there, and actually I think was instrumental in getting everybody to realize just how important it is that that we stand up to Cal-Am Water in this, I don't want to call it a fight, this discussion. So anyway, with that, I would certainly move staff recommendation that we appropriate an additional $60,000 for legal services.
Thank you. Madam City Clerk, please vote.
That motion carries 4-0 with Councilmember Fox being absent.
Thank you. And again, I just wanted to thank Supervisors Long and Parks for trying to partake in the cost, the legal cost of this particular case. All right. And of course, city staff. Always. I know that Mr. Spurgeon has had a ton of work to do regarding this. All right. Now it's on to our city manager.
Thank you. Our next regularly scheduled council meeting will be at an off-site location, as it is our annual council goal-setting session. It will be held on the 9th of May at the Grant R. Brimhall Library at 6 p.m. in the community room there. So following that meeting, our next meeting will be back here on the 30th of May, where we currently have several items on the docket, including consideration of these MCA for a secondary dwelling unit issue, so that will be a big topic, and a study session on our operating budget. And that's it for now.
Thank you, Mr. Powers. And we will now announce our closed session. That will be Mr. Heher.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Closed session 14A is conference with the legal counsel, existing litigation before the Public Utilities Commission of the State of California, application of California American Water Company U210W for authorization to increase its revenues for water service. Application number 1607002, City of Thousand Oaks, Party of Interest, pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9. The second item, 14B, will be continued to a date to be determined. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Heher. And we would like to adjourn tonight's meeting in memory of a community leader, Lon Morton, who passed away peacefully on April 17th, surrounded by his family. Lon Morton's career began as a teenager playing professional baseball with the California Angels and Cleveland Indians organizations. Drafted by the California Angels in 1963, Lon was a pitcher in their farm system for 6 years. In 1981, as a pioneer within the wealth management industry, Lon formed Morton Capital Management and served as its CEO. Lon built his business around the core values of integrity, innovation, and compassion. His drive to make an impact and improve people's lives powered everything he did, both professionally and personally. Lon served various charitable and industry organizations, but is especially recognized for his contributions to the Boys and Girls Clubs of the Greater Conejo Valley. Lon was a Boys and Girls Club board member for more than 10 years, and he served as the sponsorship chair each year at the annual Stand Up for Kids dinner and auction. He was a past recipient of the Distinguished Cal Johnston Service Award and served as chair on the Board of Governors last year. Lon and his spouse, Rocky, generously donated both their time and money to support Boys and Girls Clubs and the Newberry Park Center on the campus of Sequoia Middle School, which was dedicated last year in both their name and honor. Lon enjoyed life, family members, and many friends, and was always there to brighten the lives of others. Lon will be greatly missed. And with that, also, we would like to remember National Days of Remembrance, Holocaust Remembrance Days, this week until the 30th. And we will adjourn until our next meeting on May 9th. Good evening.